Okay, I'll be discussing inflammatory syndromes and organ dysfunction with you guys today. I've given you all a handout which is called Brief Notes on Inflammatory Syndromes and MODs. And that's because this is a very vast topic, one that you can actually talk about for days. We're just going to do a very brief overview of the next 20 minutes or so. Okay, so quite core to this topic is the subject of inflammation and what exactly inflammation is. I'm not going to discuss the detailed biochemical pathways and all of those things. What is important to know is that it's a complicated process triggered by an insult to the host, and this insult may be traumatic, it may be infective, and it may be chemical, amongst other things. And in a normal inflammatory process, this reaction is usually tightly controlled in a localized area, and it involves the release of cytokines and some cellular effectors, along with some noxious substances like free radicals and proteolytic enzymes. And this is why inflammation, although usually a good response, will also give you some tissue damage. When inflammation becomes disseminated and generalized, and you get inflammation at sites in the host, distal or far away from the organ that was primarily affected, we call that SIRS, which stands for Systemic Inflammatory Response Syndrome. Okay. How do we get from inflammation to SIRS? This is an important question because it doesn't happen in everybody, it doesn't happen all the time. And there are probably various cellular and physiological factors that play a role, but quite popular now is the 1-in-2-hit hypothesis, where a host sustains a primary insult, they have an inflammatory response, and are then hit by a second insult, which just tips them over the edge into SIRS and pushes them to that distal realm of disease known as MODs. I'll give you an example, which many of us working at USTA may understand. Patient comes in, he's got abdominal pain, a little known to us, he's got acute pancreatitis, which is already a disease associated with a lot of inflammation. The decision is made to take him to theatre. He has a large laparotomy, which is also a massive insult to his body. This is now his second insult, which then just tips him into a massive SIRS, pushes him to multi-organ dysfunction syndrome. And this is where the concept of a damage control laparotomy really comes into itself, in that a damage control laparotomy is a procedure designed to limit the second insult. You've got a massive traumatic event which creates a massive inflammatory response syndrome. You want to limit your further insult to the host and just get the patient to a point of homeostasis, which is why you do a limited surgery. Once the patient's back in homeostasis, you can bring them back. Is SIRS always pathological? And the answer to this is no, because often we see what Dennis calls a healthy SIRS in healthy post-op patients. They'll have SIRS for about a day and then they'll recover. Also, most of the patients presenting to our emergency unit probably have SIRS, if you go strictly according to what the definition of SIRS are. But most of those people respond very rapidly to their treatment, recover without any organ dysfunction, and go home without setting foot in a high care unit. SIRS becomes pathological when the host enters that vicious cycle of inflammation causing endothelial damage, and the endothelial damage causing further inflammation, and so on. You could sort of talk about it almost as a disseminated endothelial disease. Once your endothelium loses its integrity, in all sorts of sequelae which lead to generalized tissue damage and multi-organ failure. When we're talking about this topic, some definitions are very important. Like I said, SIRS is a systemic inflammatory response syndrome. If you'll just look at your printout, there's the criteria for it. Patients are supposed to have two or more of a temperature of more than 38 or less than 36 degrees Celsius, a heart rate of more than 90, a respiratory rate of more than 20, or a PCO2 of less than 4.3, a white cell count of more than 12 or less than 4, or more than 10% of immature band forms. But these are a guideline only, and they should also represent an acute change from the baseline, and you shouldn't be able to explain it away by something else. For example, I went for a run last night. After that, my heart rate was about 115, my respiratory rate was about 14, but I was not having a SIRS. I was just unfit. Sepsis is important. Sepsis is SIRS with infection. And we're moving away from the term. In the old days, people used things like bacteremia and septicemia. Bacteremia refers specifically to when you have viable bacteria in the blood. it's not necessarily a pathological condition. Septicemia, there are too many varying definitions used by different people, and so on the whole, we try to move away from using that word. What we use now is sepsis, which is SIRS with infection. Then sepsis also has various components. There's sepsis with hypotension, which is fairly self-explanatory. Patients become a bit hypotensive and normally respond to fluids. Once a patient is in septic shock, it means they're refractory to fluids and require inotropes. And once your patient is in refractory septic shock, they're non-responsive to fluids or inotropes and are in big trouble. Then MODS is multi-organ dysfunction syndrome, and MOF is multi-organ failure. Also fairly self-explanatory terms. There are various stages in the same disease, but if I can just give you an example of what the difference is. Organ dysfunction refers to when you have subclinical changes in the organ's functioning. So if you look at the kidney, if you do a blood test and you see the urea and the creatinine are up, there might be a bit of a mild electrolyte disturbance. That would be renal dysfunction. Renal failure is when the patient becomes anuric and gets distal effects of the failing kidney and it no longer works. Okay. So in your life you'll go to various lectures and you'll read various textbooks and talks and articles, and all of them will say, many of them will say things like either sepsis, septic shock or MODS are the biggest cause of death in the ICU. And this is almost a silly thing today to say because MODS is the end point of most illnesses, but it does underline the importance of how severe this disease is. And I think it's also important to understand that SIRS, septic shock and MODS, they're all part of the same disease and are various stages in that disease. Okay. Then,